What's up, gamers? I want to welcome you to the channel. My name's Cody, and today we're going to be taking a look at some Mutt Salary Cap ranked gameplay. Pretty excited to play this game. I've been trying out some new things with my salary cap lineup. I have tailored down my kicker. I've also tanked my quarterback, actually. I'm using the base Ryan Mallett. I'm trying to see how far down I can go and still be pretty effective at the quarterback position. I've also grabbed some new types of players on defense. I'm using the out-of-position Colby Fleener. The main reason is because I feel like in my defense I need some good block shed, and so he's been helping me out there with that because he has pretty decent block shed, but he can also catch kind of like the threshold for me is about 60. If you can catch it 60 normally, you're going to be able to do good. And then my linebackers, doing a couple different things here. And I don't have my lineup quite set up yet. But I'm using Ryan Shazier, and I'm also using Bud Dupree. And the main reason I'm using them is because of their jump rating. Because they have a really high jumping rating, what that's going to do for me, in theory, what I'm trying to get it to do anyway, is I'm trying to get them to basically jump over, like on those deep post routes and stuff. I'm trying to get them to play that. That's the idea, because I was thinking about this underneath yellow zones, and that you don't really need zone coverage, because really what zone coverage comes into play when you're talking about how the only time I think zone coverage comes into play is when you're going up for like aggressive catches. And when you're a linebacker, normally you're not having to deal with aggressive catches. You're underneath. And so the theory really is centered around that kind of concept. And we'll see how it works out for us today. But yeah. And then I'm running the... I should show you guys my lineup. But yeah, I'm just trying that out. Let me know if you guys think that's a decent idea. But basically, yeah, I just went to Mutthead and looked at the jumping ratings and tried to find some guys that had some decent speed and decent jumping. I think speed is really actually a lot more important than people realize this year. I don't value speed at certain positions, but at other positions I really value speed. Like corner, you need, depending on what style of defense you play, if you're going to leave your corners on an island, you need speed. It's almost like a must-have. But if you're not going to leave your corners on an island, then you don't really need speed. So it's just kind of like, for me, I leave my corners on an island, so I need a pretty good speed rating. You just kind of have to pick and choose how you play. But anyway. So I switched the playbooks to Kansas City finally. I was trying out the Bengals, but I wanted to see what I could do from Kansas City, because I really like this bunch. But the cool part about Kansas City's playbook is it has couple of other formations in it that really do a good job. It has all the good stuff. I mean, it has the gun empty chief, which is always good. It has this Y trips, which what I really like about this is a really good inside zone, even though Derek Coleman's not quite the best. He's a good running back, but he's not top running back, but he does do good enough for me anyway, because I don't run the ball a ton. But when I do, you know, he can normally get it done. So, starting out in this bunch. And Ryan Mallett throws a dot. That's what I'm saying, man. The golden ticket, Johnny Manziel, or like the whatever, you know, all those top tier guys. A lot of guys are using them, but I just don't. I don't know. I mean, outside of throwing on the run, like when you throw on the run, I can see it. I can see it matter a lot because I don't. I try not to. I don't really ever try to throw on the run. I mainly just sit in the pocket and do that. I mean, there was another dot. See, I mean, and I'm not doing anything different with Ryan Mallett. But there is a little pro tip here for you guys: is when you are in that situation where when you're in the situation where you need to throw the ball, like when you're passing from shotgun especially, But what you want to do is you want to, as soon as the ball is snapped, I've been doing this a lot lately, and it's really helped me out. You want to hold left, or you want to kind of tap left trigger as soon as the ball is snapped. And what that's going to do is it's going to get your quarterback, it's going to cancel the drop back. And this is something I just started doing probably last week, but I can't tell you how much success I've had with it. It has literally saved me from so many sacks because, when you're in the heat of the game, you don't think about that and you just drop back, 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 and they just get that outside contain and you're kind of screwed. Like, there's not really anything you can do. There's a dot over the middle. But defensively, I've also tried a couple new things. I'm using a little bit more of a stronger interior line to see how they do and hold up against the run. I'm kind of testing and tinkering some things out. I really want to see if the strength and block shed combination matters or not. But yeah. There's a corner route. Oh, I thought I could get there. I was using the Antonio Cromartie Ultimate Legend Speed Edition. And the only problem with him was he, like, when he would get blocked, he'd just get pancaked. Like, he could never get off a block. So that's why I'm kind of thinking block shed may be more important. But he made some awesome user plays. He has 99 speed and like 98 Excel. But he has like 98 speed, 99 speed, 98 acceleration, and like 97 agility. And he also has really good catching, but his best stat by far is he has, I think, 100 jumping. And the jump rating is really what I was after. But like I said, he couldn't. If basically, if you ran an inside zone on me, I mean, there was not a whole lot I could do. There's a little quick pitch. I tell you what, man, I don't really ever have any trouble stopping tosses because my defense, the way that it kind of comes out of the line of scrimmage, is very wide anyway. All right, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna try. Well, Casilius. So I want to put Bud Dupree here, Shazier here, Casilius here. I've been trying to use this a little bit more. There we go. So last time he was in this, we got a corner route on this left side, and we also got a little route over the middle. One of the important things I like to do early on, and this is something I've just started kind of going back to, is paying attention, using the early parts of the game to kind of fill my opponent out. And I don't ever do that enough. But basically, what I'm trying to get accomplished here is cover two man is obviously the best coverage in the game by far. I mean, and you can do so much with it. You can make so many adjustments out of it. The man coverage itself is good, and then you just make some adjustments. Like right here, I'm gonna drop my corner and, or my safety over here into a buzz or flat and play over the top. And here's a post. And we get a nice interception from Rodgers. But the thing about cover two man that I like is when they start to roll, like if your pressure doesn't have to get in because the coverage is so good, and so you get a lot of coverage sacks out of it. So on like third and long, what I like to do is I really am a big fan of just playing cover two man in the beginning of the game and just kind of seeing how that goes. Yeah, so far so good for Ryan Mallett though, and like I said, I really like the taller quarterbacks because I feel like they have a better time of like not throwing the ball into the lineman all the time, and I throw a lot of like low pass leads and different things like that. So yeah, that's pretty much the main reason why, and normally it works out pretty well. There's Coleman. Cool part about Coleman is he can catch too. He's got 92 speed, and he's also got pretty good catching stats. best part about the Kansas City playbook that's better than the Bengals is you have this little halfback base, and it's not a great run, but it's a good enough run to where they have to you can actually mix it in. So here he's probably going to man to man. And he drops that. As soon as I talk up Coleman, he goes out and drops it. That's the one problem. That's why I was thinking of running with like the Stanley Havili card, and I was probably thinking of like putting him at running back and then grabbing the Marcel Reese, but the Marcel Reese is freaking hard to get. I've still not been able to get him. Ugh. James Jones. I forgot to low pass lead that, so only my receiver can get it. That route is really, really finicky. It's kind of almost too. It's so hard to throw. It's one of those routes that, like, if you throw it wrong, you're screwed. There's just nothing you can do. And anyway, the more you tinker with it, the better you get. But. So it throws a little swing pass out to Dree Archer. I think he's running that campus hero, Dree Archer. He's got the Brady. What I'm finding with two-man under, too, this year, the more I run it, because I just recently started running more two-man under. Like, I really haven't ran much two-man under at all for most of the year. But what I've found is a couple things that I think are really important is that I don't know that man coverage is that big of a deal. Except for on, like, routes, like C routes and corner routes. And, oh, my gosh, that should have been an interception. Dang it. But similar to that zone coverage thing, man, like, I think the only time that man coverage really, really plays a big-time factor is when you're dealing with, like, aggressive catches or unbumpable routes. The better your man coverage, the better you're going to deal with unbumpable routes, and the better your man coverage, the better you're going to have a chance at getting them in one-on-one situations. But other than that, I haven't had a ton of issues with, like, leaving my linebackers in man against a tight end or something like that. And so that's taught me a lot about this, man-to-man. So we got Herman Moore, I think, on that far right. So there's a slant, and so the slant was covered good. I'm also running the out-of-position Ronnie Lott. I was thinking about switching over to the Devin McCourty, the final edition Devin McCourty for my slot corner, but the thing about the Ronnie Lott is that he does a really, really good job. Dang it. Nice throw. So right there is an example. Runs a smash concept. He has that outside leverage. Devin Hester, campus hero with speed. Does a really good job there. So he comes out in goal line here. Let's see what he does. Oh my gosh. I don't know what's the deal with the offside stuff, but it really drives me insane. Like, I'm so over the offside. It's like, there's nothing you can do. Like, that's the thing about it. It's like, nothing you can do. As much as I like this game, there's a couple of things in it I just wish they would fix up a little bit. Like, the timeout stuff where you, on PlayStation 4, I don't even know how it happens, but basically, if you make too many hot routes or too fast, or I don't know what it is, but basically you get where you can't snap the ball. And that drives me up the wall. Because, like, I've had so many close games where I'll have to burn a timeout. And it really affects my game. All right. Back to the offense. There's a dot. James Jones. And like I said, I mean, so far so good. The interception. I can't remember even how. Oh yeah, I had a bad pass lead. Throws a dot. Oh, come on, drop that baby in there, Ryan Mallett. I've been trying to work a little bit more on that cover too, of being able to drop the corner in over the top. But for some reason
it's still kind of struggling a little bit. But I think that's kind of the big thing with the Ryan Mallets, and the more I use them, the more I realize like there's just a few throws that they probably shouldn't even try to make. There's my boy Derek Coleman. The thing about Derek Coleman is you want to use him as like a trucking back. You don't want to use him like a, you know, like a standard runner. All right, so we're running verticals here. Check down to that slant. He's been getting a heavy dosage. Part of the thing too with your routes this year, especially, and I notice this so much more this year, is you've got to mix up your motion snaps. You've got to basically, if you run a flat on one motion snap, you want to run a drag on the next one. And I'm finding that that's a very big deal in this year's game. Because the reason it's such a big deal in this year's game is because guys will user, but the thing is with your user, like, it's so hard to adjust your user. So if you're going to user a sideline, it becomes very difficult to user the sideline and still be effective, and still be effective on like a another breaking route. Oh dang it, Ryan Mallett. I am noticing it like on stuff like that where like you'll basically, and what it comes down to really is you're not set. That's why you need to use that left trigger tactic. But the other thing too is like you want to be careful what routes you use the high pass lead on. And I have a tendency to kind of just utilize that high pass lead so much. So here we get quarter three deep. So I'm thinking it's going to be zone. There's Jordy Nelson. Just basically, that was just a late read. He just comes back across the middle like that, and we're able to get in for six. Let's see what we can do here. I don't have James Casey in my lineup anymore. Don't have that single back bunch, unfortunately, in Kansas City's book, but we're able to get by with just the standard I-form twins. This I-form twins, there's a lot of good things you can do on the red zone. On the goal line. In the goal line. There's, when you're in that kind of 5 to 10 yards from the goal line, there's a lot of things you can do, and it makes it really, really good. There's Brandon Watts coming down, laying some lumber. So here he's got 40 seconds. So that's plenty of time. And three timeouts. So my thought process right here is that I got to play heavy, heavy sideline. I got to take away the sideline from him, know that there's that crossing pattern over the middle that he can go to. And then if he goes to the tight end, I got to watch this running back. There's a swing pass. There's that post, and I got back on at that time. So right there he went with smash again, I think. Yep. And he has the post to the tight end. But he's also got that corner route on that side. So anyway, so we were able to get that. Right here, we're going to go cover four shell. And my thought process here is watch these crossing patterns. There's D'Angelo Hall. He's going to make that play 9 times out of 10. D'Angelo Hall, I'm running his signature series. He's got 99 zone coverage and 97 speed. So that does pretty well for me. So here we're going to go man-to-man. And I'm going to try to plant Gibson to really deter him throwing that. And I'm going to put Ronnie Lott in the deep secondary here. Yep, we got him. So he was going to that corner route again, and we were able to make that adjustment We were able to make that adjustment over there and tweak the defense a little bit. We should get the ball back here, maybe able to get a field goal before half, and that's going to really put some pressure on him. It looks like he's going to go for this. And right here, I mean, this is pretty simple. What I like to do in this situation is I like to go two men under, and we're going to play outside coverage, outside leverage. And basically, we're just watching. So there's Gibson. He's going to make that play, and he may quit out here. But right here on offense, the big thing here, what I like to do is I like to take a couple shots to the end zone and see what we've got. Because we got one timeout, 23 seconds. So, you know, he's probably going to go man-to-man. And so we're going to try to take a dot there. We'll take a timeout here. Unfortunately, now, because I was trying to get him to – the main reason I even went to that route was because I was trying to get him to go out of bounds. But he didn't end up doing that for me. There's your boy Boyd making a nice catch in the end zone, and Ryan Mallett throws a dime to him. Let's see what we can do. Go back to the two-point conversion. Need to get Jordy Nelson here. Looks like we're gonna have to eat that. Dang it, that sucks. Take three, we go up 23-7. I think wonder if we get ball at half or not. Tell you what, I've had some really bad connection issues. I don't know what's going on with this, but I've had a ton of issues with kicking field goals. Brandon Watts. Alright, so 12 seconds here. I'm just going to go man-to-man. Keep everything in the middle. There's a big sack. Ryan Shazier. I'll get ball in half. So right now, I mean, obviously, if you're just playing for wins, you just take it out and come out. We're in a couple inside zones. Oh, looks like he's going to go ahead and quit out. So, anyways, guys, that was a pretty good half. I want to show you guys Ryan Mallett and just kind of show you some of the things I've been doing. Surprisingly, Ryan Mallett played very, very well for me. So, again, I'm going to recommend going a little bit lower on the quarterback, because I think that as long as you set your feet, try not to throw on the run too much, works out pretty well.